It's day two of the LSU Tiger Crossover Classic, and we've got a real rivalry game for you on the SEC ESPN Network. The Louisiana Ragin' Cajuns from Lafayette taking on the LSU Tigers from the SEC. Come on inside the ballpark, everyone, with Hall of Fame coach Yvette Girard. I'm Lynn Rollins. Yvette, LSU yesterday won for the 13th straight time, an 11-0 victory over Texas A&M Corpus Christi. And Taylor Pleasance, the number one RBI producer in the country, got things started early for the Tigers.
In the bottom of the first, the All-America shortstop came through with a two RBI single to score Sierra Briggs and Danica Coffey to give LSU a 2-0 lead. Then in the bottom of the second, Georgia Clark launched her third home run of the season, a three-run shot that gave the Tigers a 7-0 lead after two. In the bottom of the third, Savannah Stewart hit her first home run of the season, a three-run shot that put the Tigers on top 10-0 after three. Allie Newland got in on the action in the bottom of the fourth, singling in Madeline Giglio, and the Tigers won it 11-0 on a run rule in five innings.
Freshman Ailee Johnson was the starter in the circle for LSU. It was her third start, her third victory. She pitched shutout softball.
The freshman looked really good once again, going four innings and allowing just three hits on 73 pitches. She walked only one batter and struck out five.
So we are just about set to go here. Let's look at Jerry Glasgow. The Cajuns are 7-5. They won their first five games, and then they went to a very elite tournament in Clearwater, Florida, and went 1-5 in that tournament. They do have a victory today in a game preceding this one, 5-2 over Texas A&M Corpus Christi. This place will be rocking the entire afternoon long. There's hardly a seat to be had. Let's take a look at the Cajuns lineup. Davis, Hayden, Kostelnik, Campbell, Heath, Longaliers, Valdez, Vasquez, and Falterman. And this is a lineup that can be very, very potent. In the circle for the LSU Tigers, Raylan Chafin gets the start. This will be her fourth game to start. She's worked almost 13 innings, a 1.66 ERA, four walks, 10 strikeouts. Chafin in the circle for LSU. Now, remember, these teams will play in Lafayette tomorrow.
Chafin will throw a curve, a rise, and a screw. She was one batter shy of a perfect game against Alabama last year.
And here we go with hardly any room to be had in the stands or the berm. Lots of folks everywhere, lots of sunshine. It's warm. The wind is blowing out toward left center field. The Cajuns and the Tigers, one of the best rivalries in the country.
No question. 60 miles apart, Battle of the Bayou, Battle of Interstate 10. Battle of families, call it what you want, it'll be a good one.
Maya Davis at the top of the order has only played in two games. She was hit on the hand in the first game of the season and suffered an injury, and she just came back from that in the game preceding this one. But she is a real speedster. She's already stolen six bases. You've got to keep her off the base paths. And LSU does, as Coffey handles the one-hop chop at third base and throws out Maya Davis.
Chafin does her job getting ahead and getting that first out.
Let's look at LSU defensively. Newland, Briggs, and Rudity in the outfield, and that's a really good one. Coffey and Gutierrez are on the corners on the infield. Pleasance and Petty, the double P's, on the middle infielders, and Chafin and the sophomore, the freshman Bergeron, form the battery today. Here is Matty Hayden, batting 324.
And she's a good one, just a sophomore following in her sister's footsteps for the Cajuns.
Hayden had a four-game hitting streak, ended in the game preceding this one. She is one of seven 300 or better hitters in the lineup for the Cajuns. Lots of sunshine, some puffy clouds. Fans are here elbow to elbow with a lot of spirit, a lot of purple for LSU, a lot of red for the Cajuns. A liner out to left comes down in the glove of Newland, two outs on a ground ball left side and a fly ball to Newland in left. It's warm today. We were up in the 80s yesterday.
Suntan lotion. When I drove up to the ballpark, I saw people lathering up.
Right now, 83 degrees. The winds are out of the north at 6 to 13 miles an hour. No chance of rain, but just about ideal conditions. Magnificent February weather for softball. 83 degrees right now. And the sky is the color of some faded denim jeans.
This is a good-looking ball player here, Stormy Kotzelnik.
Kotzelnik hitting 320. This is her ninth start. She's had eight base hits, one homer, five driven in. This young lady is from Carmel, Indiana. Jerry Glasgow has gone all over the country in the few years he's been in Lafayette and recruited players literally from coast to coast.
Oh, besides being the hitting coach, he does a phenomenal job of recruiting athletes. Of course, he's from the Midwest, and Coach Summerball won a national tournament when he was doing that, so a ton of connections via that avenue.
This is his sixth season. He's won nearly 80% of his games. And in the Sun Belt Conference, there's the Cajuns and nobody else.
That's absolutely correct. They really don't have a rival. I guess they might have a couple of rivals, but there's no really other team that has pushed them to the limit.
Well, to be considered a rival, you've got to win
exactly,
some games.
Exactly.
And the Cajuns, in 10 straight years, have not lost a Sun Belt Conference series.
Well, this Cajun program could have been in the SEC for a long time. This is a phenomenal program that made its national mark a long time ago and hasn't lost it.
Well, let me put it like this, and this is almost hard to believe. The Cajuns have won 74 consecutive Sun Belt Conference series. That's exactly 10 years worth.
Who does that?
Here's the 2-2 pitch. Bounced on a couple of hops left side. Petty spears it and gets it over to Gutierrez. And Chafin has a 1-2-3 inning. LSU will be coming to bat in the bottom of the first against Louisiana's Trajan Cajuns when we come back. This is the batting order for the LSU Tigers, and the first four you see there, Coffee, Briggs, Pleasants, and Clark, all are hitting above 400. Pleasants leads the country in runs batted in. There's another 300 hitter in the lineup, and that's Petty, and that lineup will take its cuts against the former SEC pitcher, Megan Shoreman. Shoreman started her career at Kentucky.
Her bread and butter is her backdoor curve. She's really developed a change to become a dominant pitcher. She's got a great low rise ball.
Three wins, two losses this year for Shoreman. She's started four games. She's appeared in six. 24 innings of work, 17 hits allowed. Five walks, her control has been good. And 27 strikeouts, so better than a strikeout per inning. She can be a dominant pitcher.
She throws big pitches in tight situations.
Here's the 1-1 to Coffee.
There's that changeup we talked about.
Shoreman is coming off a no-hit performance at UCF, 25th-ranked UCF on Tuesday night. Five innings, one walk, four strikeouts, no hits allowed.
8-0 run rule by the Cajuns after a disappointing showing at the tournament, but they were very competitive in every game except one. And it came down to the last pitch of the last inning. There was a lot of comebacks by the Cajuns to even the score or make it a one-run ball game. So they took some lumps on that trip, but certainly helped their RPI situation.
Coffee has a three-game hitting streak. She and Briggs lead the team with 19 hits through the first 13 games. And Coffey, over the course of two seasons, has been on base in 29 consecutive contests.
Well, imperative for the Cajuns to keep Coffey off the base paths because, you know, with Coffey and Briggs, that just allows Pleasance to do her thing.
The 3-2 pitch slapped foul the other way. Yvette, there was a time when these teams didn't play all that often, but that's in the past, and this is really good for both schools. It's really good for Louisiana softball fans, and by that I mean the entire state, and it's really good for the game nationally.
Well, it's past history. You got two coaches that don't have any history with each other, and it's, as you said, it is a good thing for college softball, good thing for the fans.
So Coffey draws a base on balls, and that makes it 30 straight games in which she has been to first base. She does not need a guide dog or a GPS to lead her way around the bases. Defensively, Falterman, Davis, and Campbell, Kalsenik, Langoliers, Vasquez, and Hayden. Valdez is catching, Shoreman is pitching.
Cajuns field at a 961 clip.
Riggs at the plate.
Not so sure that wasn't maybe a pitch out there, thinking that Coffey was going to go on that first pitch. She was certainly set up way outside.
Riggs is in her third year. Before this season, she had a 360 career batting average, which was sixth best in LSU history. And for you LSU aficionados and want to go back in time a little bit, I'm going to throw out this quiz question. Who is number one in career highest batting average among LSU softball players? What player in the LSU softball program is the career highest batting average?
Jake,
she was a center fielder.
Kirsten Shortridge.
You are correct, madam.
Woman among children.
Let's look at this LSU crossover tournament history. This is the seventh time these teams have played under this format. LSU has won five of the previous six games. The Cajuns actually won the first game a few years ago, 2-1. That was in 2020. Since then, it's been all LSU victories in the crossover tournament. Now, they will play in Lafayette tomorrow.
And I get to call that game, so...
So you're getting a little warm-up tonight.
Got Tigers and Cajuns for 24 hours.
By the way, Kristen Shortridge in her career hit .417 for LSU, and that's the highest career batting average among a Tiger. 3-0 on Briggs. Four-game hitting streak for Briggs. She takes all the way. Coffey at first base.
That wasn't a pitch out, I'll correct myself. They were trying to just go with a screwball in the outside corner.
Beth Tarina has won just under 70% of her games in this her 12th year coaching third base for the Tigers and being the head coach, of course. Briggs gets the bunt down left side. Well played by Hayden at third base. That will go as a sacrifice, but Briggs beats her share out of those types of bunts. But Hayden jumped on it quickly at third base. Coffey moves up to second. LSU playing for a run here in the first.
And every time you see this lineup for the Cajuns, it changes a little bit. Hayden was an outfielder. Just a great ball player. Briggs probably would have liked to have deadened that ball a little bit, but nonetheless, she did her job. Sacrificed the run to second. Tigers have a runner in scoring position for Pleasance.
And Tigers have the number one RBI producer in the country at the plate with 23. She had two yesterday.
Shoreman having a little trouble locating that screwball for a strike. She's just a little off the plate.
Briggs, five homers, a .419 average, a country leading 23 RBI. First base is not occupied. Georgia Clark is on deck.
I don't think she's gotten that screwball over for a strike yet. And it's a pitch that she really needs against How many lefties today in the lineup? It's usually seven or eight.
Let me check it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Clark and Bergeron are the only two non-left-handed hitters in the lineup.
Good-looking low rise ball from Shoreman. A swing and a miss from Pleasance. And that low rise has been a really good pitch for Shoreman so far this year.
A runner at second base with one out, bottom of the first. The Cajuns and the Tigers. No more need be said.
By the way, I just got to go on record of saying I love the Cajuns throwback uniform. We used to wear those back in the day, and they're just really clean looking. Got a lot of texts from the former players saying, hey, we wore those.
The 3-1 pitch is fouled back. If you want further statistical support of Pleasance's effectiveness with runners on base, she is hitting .455 with runners in scoring position.
That's why they're going to be very careful throwing to her.
The 3-2 pitch, one out, Coffee at second base. Pleasance takes a full swing and lifts it into the parking lot.
And it's that rise ball again.
Don't you love these battles? We look around the ballpark. There's hardly an empty seat. Purple and red dispersed throughout the crowd. Lots of sunshine. 83 degrees. Cajuns and Tigers first inning, no score.
It's a win-win today. If your team doesn't win, at least you'll get a suntan.
The 3-2 pitch ripped into right center field. This will be another RBI for the nation's leader. Pleasance on her way to second base. She makes it standing. Pleasance on a 3-2 pitch. Cranks her second double of the season, and that one got to the wall on a couple of hops in a hurry. Coffee easily strolling in from second base.
Pleasance has just been incredible this year. Shoreman starting behind with that screwball, and thinking we might have seen a good-looking changeup there, but Pleasance making the most of the opportunity, not leaving people on base when she gets up to the plate.
So Pleasance coming into this season ranked third all-time in slugging percentage in an LSU uniform at .610. Bianca Bell at .679 is number one in that category. And Pleasance certainly making her mark with another extra base hit. Georgia Clark was seventh all-time with a .582 slugging percentage. She's at the plate right now.
And there's that changeup that she just can't locate, but you got to keep throwing it. You got to keep throwing it.
Clark had a home run yesterday as she lined one down the left field line.
And Clark's batting average is very, very good. She's just not quite hitting those home runs yet, although she did this past week.
She tucked yesterday's home run around the left field foul pole, and it got into that bleacher area very quickly.
Well, again, you know, she hit one yesterday. She hit one on the road, went on the North Louisiana swing.
Clark batting a whopping .438. 10 driven in, 3 homers. Let's go back and look at the home run swing last night.
Well, like you said, it was a no-doubter off the bat.
That was an ice pick out into left field. Georgia waits. Georgia swings. Georgia delivers one, which will two-hop the wall. Pleasance scores. Back-to-back base hits. Georgia Clark drives in a run. And that one got to the wall so quickly, Clark could not take an extra base.
Clark is so strong, and what an asset this is now that Pleasance is on fire. So, got pick your poison here.
This ball takes a couple of hops, bounces against the wall. Pleasance easily scores. Clark held to an RBI single, and here is Mackenzie Rudity. LSU off to a 2-0 lead. Coffee walked and scored on the Pleasance RBI double. Pleasance has crossed the plate on the RBI single by Clark. Here we go.
Got some action in the Cajun bullpen, and Shoreman just is not quite sharp.
Rudity takes a strike from Megan Shoreman. The Cajuns picked up a win against the Islanders from Texas A&M Corpus Christi in a game preceding this one. LSU last night beat that Islanders team 11-0. Rudity out of Franklin, North Carolina.
We keep saying came in a little injured last year and didn't quite. She had a good freshman year, but they expected big things out of her. And so far this year, we're seeing exactly what the coaches saw when they recruited her. The only North Carolina softball athlete ever.
Chloe Riasetto is in the bullpen for this Cajun team.
A lefty.
One ball, two strikes on LSU's right fielder. Clark at first. Rudity lifts one off to the left side. I don't think there will be a play, and there is not.
Should be a souvenir.
Couple of base hits, couple of runs in the first for the Tigers. Carly Petty is on deck. And she will bat if Rudity stays out of a double play. The outfield is maybe a step deeper than normal and straight away. The pitch. Flicked foul again. Rudity spoils that one. Coffey and Pleasance have crossed the plate. Pleasance and Clark have RBI base hits. By the way, those base hits move that pair's hitting streak to five games for both of them. Rudity recognized that off-speed pitch and then pulled it foul.
So we have seven in the lineup today, lefties?
Mm-hmm. And this will be the 30th pitch coming from Morgan Shoreman in a laborious first inning, let's say. Shoreman just trying to find a rhythm here.
Yeah.
This Cajun team certainly has the offensive firepower to make up two runs.
Absolutely.
But LSU really wants to make profit while it can, and Rudity chases a pitch that was out of the strike zone.
Big rise ball, as you said, out of the rise ball, but she came inside on her. Rudity could not hold off. Just love that pitch in the eyes, but it just kept rising.
Here's Carly Petty, the new second baseman for the Tigers.
What an addition Petty has been for the Tigers.
Adding
a bat to the lineup.
Well, a 351 bat right now. This is her 14th start. She's driven in 10. Couple of doubles among her 13 base hits.
Graduate students from Oklahoma State and Beth Tarina has said that Petty's running the infield, which is amazing since you've got Pleasance over there at shortstop that's been there for 3 years now, and Petty's a first-year girl.
Two and oh on Carly Petty. Petty lays off the pitch. It's 3-0.
That would have been an outstanding pitch if she could have located that a little higher. Totally would have handcuffed Petty. Woulda, coulda, shoulda, though.
Petty is a nursing major, pursuing a master's in healthcare administration. You know, Yvette, this is interesting to me. She says the people she'd most like to meet, one of them is Elvis Presley.
Oh, she's loves 80s music.
Elvis was gone in the 70s.
I know, but she, you know, she's kind of an old soul with the music she likes and the people she admires.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Here we go with a 3-2 pitch. Two on the board for the Tigers in the first. Petty lifts this one to the left side. It will carry out to Falterman. She makes a one-handed stab, and that ends the inning. But the Tigers got an RBI double from Pleasance, and this RBI base hit by Georgia Clark. And take a 2-0 lead over the Cajuns in front of a full house in Tiger Park. Welcome back to Tiger Park on a gorgeous late February afternoon for softball. LSU had a productive first inning and leads the Raging Cajuns 2-0. With Yvette Girard, I'm Len Rollins. We are deeply appreciative of your decision to spend some time with us this afternoon in Baton Rouge. An update from Round Rock, Texas. LSU suffered its first baseball defeat of the season as Iowa got off to a quick start and beat LSU 12-4. Yesterday, LSU won the first game of that three-game tournament against Kansas State 7-3, but loses today 12-4 to Iowa, and the Baseball Tigers will take on Sam Houston to wrap up the tournament tomorrow. Jordan Campbell hitting a solid 320.
Jordan Campbell, transfer from Texas A&M. You know, we talk about if you could design a softball player, and we say for LSU, it would be Pleasance. I'm thinking Campbell from the Cajuns. What a great-looking athlete.
8 driven in for Campbell. From Kingwood, Texas, a junior. Campbell at the plate, just physically, kind of reminds me of a right-handed hitting Taylor Pleasance. A tall target, powerfully built, very confident at the plate. And the 2-1 pitch. Chafin cranked that one low and inside.
That was Chafin's screwball that didn't land. Now she's fallen behind, the leadoff hitter for the Cajuns.
Chafin had walked 4 in 12 and two-thirds innings coming into this game. Coffey cuts in front of Pleasant, slings it over in time for the out.
That's a great play by Coffey to cut towards the mound. Sometimes those balls are just, if the pitcher doesn't get it, third baseman doesn't get it, you're not going to get an out.
Well, look at the schedule and the results. The Raging Cajuns have played a postseason playoff type schedule, losing to Oklahoma State, Arkansas, number one UCLA. Good battle there.
They had that game. They were winning that game with two outs in the seventh inning and lost.
And then UCF, the ranked win, with Shorman throwing the no-hitter earlier in the week.
Not quite as sharp today. Doesn't mean she can't find it. But that game against UCLA is number one right now, so it just shows that the Cajuns, ouch, can produce.
Carly Heath got that one on the right arm, it appeared. She's all right.
Now that is second baseman number 23, Alexa Langlier.
Chafin on the season has been especially effective against right-handed hitters, not so much against lefties. Left-handed batters are hitting 435 against her. That's powerful. And she's held right-handed batters to a 207 average. So something is working against righties that's not working against lefties.
Langlier's leads the Cajuns with RBIs with 12 and home runs with 3.
Also has a triple and a double.
So a dangerous hitter up here.
Indeed she is. Half of her hits have been for extra bases. She's on a three-game hitting streak. We play in the Ragin' Cajun half of the second. LSU scored two in the first.
Langoliers didn't get to play in the regional tournament last year. She had COVID. That was a huge loss for the Cajuns. Tiger fans not happy with that. Screwball inside, call for a ball.
Lyndon Baptiste is working the plate. Craig Elmore is the first base umpire, and Brian Crochet is the third base umpire. Here's the 2-1 pitch. Lifted behind the circle near second base and grabbed by Petty. Two outs, Heath remains at first. These Ragin' Cajuns have won 18 regular season Sunbelt Conference championships. They've won 17 Sunbelt Conference championship tournaments. They are the three-time defending regular season and tournament champion. And it's been 10 years, fully 10 years, since they last lost a Sunbelt Conference series. 74 consecutive times the Cajuns have won Sunbelt Conference series.
And don't you know the Sunbelt members, when the coaching change happened, must have been licking their chops, but nope. Same result. Jerry Glasgow, the only non-alum. Here we go. Here
Valdez we go. Hits one high, hits it deep, and that one's caught by a Ragin' Cajun fan. A couple of rows beyond the left field wall, and we've got a brand new ball game. A second home run of the season for Victoria Valdez. And on one swing, the Cajuns make a complete answer.
Two home runs for her this year. Let's see what this pitch is here. I won't be able to tell from the side, but good job of staying in tight on that ball. Just barreled it up and it got out of here.
So the first hit for the Cajuns results in the first couple of runs. And that one out plunk of Heath proved to be especially damaging.
We're going to have a pinch hitter.
Well, Vasquez is scheduled to bat. Cecilia Vasquez, the shortstop.
Valdez has been a stud so far for the Cajuns. She's usually playing third base, but she's catching today.
Well, this is Vasquez at the plate now. So the freshman gets a bat. She's 6 for 25. One double this year. She's been pretty much the full-time starter. And Georgia Clark, or excuse me, Raylene Gutierrez at first base makes the play. But Victoria Valdez on this swing has tied it. She got the momentum in the pitch, hits it high and deep into the left field bleachers. And on that swing, we've got a brand new ball game. Two in the first for LSU, two in the second for the Cajuns. LSU used a couple of base hits and a walk in the first inning to score two runs. The Cajuns came back to tie it on a hit batter and a home run by Valdez. The first hit of the day for the Cajuns, and we go to the third, or to the bottom of the inning, and LSU, with Allie Newland coming to the plate, is in a 2-2 ball game.
Now Shorman has new life. Let's see if she can work ahead here.
Megan Shorman, the transfer from Kentucky, gets ready again in the circle. Newland, Bergeron, and Gutierrez are the scheduled hitters here in the second inning for LSU. First pitch is a strike at the letters. Newland is a junior hitting 233. This is her 13th start. She has divided time between left field, and she's a really good left fielder, and as a backup catcher. Nine driven in, one home run, and she takes a full swing and can't find it and falls behind two strikes.
And now Sherman's working ahead, so now she can use her big movement. Got that crucial first pitch strike.
And Newland waves at another high pitch. It's been feast or famine for her much of this year. LSU is seeking its 17th consecutive NCAA regional appearance. Picked to finish fifth in the SEC preseason poll. Last year, the Tigers finished tied for fourth. And Kilponen and Briggs and Pleasants were preseason all-conference selections.
And the coaching staff really feels that that's really a low prognosis for this team. They really love this team a lot and think they have a chance to win it all. And right now, they're the only undefeated SEC team.
Florida suffered a defeat yesterday. That was Florida and LSU going into yesterday were the only unbeaten teams in the SEC. And Florida has suffered a loss. Actually, a couple of them now. They lost yesterday and they lost today.
Can't win them all. I know people want you to, but it's too many games.
Bergeron out of Rain, Louisiana. A very highly acclaimed recruit for the Tigers. Hitting 214. She has started 11 games as a rookie. Couple of runs driven in. Macy Bergeron. The outfield is straight away in medium depth. One out in the bottom of the second. Shoreman rips that one right through the strike zone, and Bergeron is left standing.
And Shoreman got a little bit of giddy up now, got a little bit of her confidence back with those two runs. Was so shaky in the first inning, and look at that beautiful screwball there.
That's a belt-high pitch on the inner part of the plate. Two quick strikeouts now for Shoreman. She's got three on the day. And this brings on Raylene Gutierrez. Hitting 250, 5 for 20. One triple and an RBI.
Utility player, can play first, can play in the outfield just as effectively. Great defensive player and more than capable offensively. And once again, one more lefty in that lineup.
She'll start with an open stance and then close it. That's just wide.
Nibbling at that corner, trying to get that call.
2-0. Nobody on base, two outs. Bottom of the second, 2-2 game. There's a wind blowing right to left. Here we go at 2-0. That's elevated.
Good job right there by not biting at that rise ball. Got a couple of the Tigers preceding hitters.
Three and one now as Shoreman finds the strike zone. That's a little bit off the plate. Shoreman didn't think so. Gutierrez becomes a two-out base runner with the second walk of the game from Shoreman. LSU's game tomorrow in Lafayette against these Cajuns will start at 2:30 Central Time. You know, we're only a couple of weeks away from the return of daylight savings time. And my goodness, I wish we would finally just settle on it and
Absolutely. Stay
with daylight savings time.
What?
Now, it's my understanding the Senate has passed that legislation, but the U.S. House of Representatives won't look at it.
What's the deal?
I don't know.
I just think it's terrible when you see little kids in the dark in the morning waiting for the bus.
I don't ever see them. I don't have to get up that early. Are you still an early riser?
Not really, but every now and then. But I'm just shocked when I do that.
You're just making a point on principle.
Right.
I understand. Here's Coffey, who walked and scored in the first. Gutierrez at first base. Let's see if she might be off with the pitch. She is not. She has attempted one steal this year, and she made it. LSU does not run a lot. Briggs is the most frequent base stealer. She's 4 out of 5. Coffey is 2 out of 3, and they by far are the leaders on the team.
And the Cajuns aren't running as much as he used to. I mean, he never had a stop sign before. People did not burn on first base, that's for sure.
The 1-2 pitch. Slapped foul past third. Newland and Bergeron went down on strikes. Gutierrez coaxed a walk from Shorman. She's at first base and Coffey at the plate. Here's the 1-2. Lifted high in the air to center field. Davis has a play. She starts back left. Now she reverses right and she's got it. And that ends the second inning. We go to the third. Both teams have a deuce on the scoreboard. Well, surprise, surprise, surprise. Louisiana, again, ranked number one in the Sun Belt preseason poll. Texas State and South Alabama and Troy, perhaps, expected to maybe challenge the Cajuns, but the Cajuns in the Sun Belt Conference are like what UCLA used to be in men's basketball under John Wooden. They're like what the Celtics used to be in the NBA, and they're like what the Yankees used to be in the American League. Nobody beats them.
Good analogy.
Kayla Falterman at the plate first.
Osco smiling a little bit more now.
Chafin rips one through the zone. Strike one.
Chafin's thrown well, except for that one pitch.
Falterman is out of the Woodlands, Texas, a suburb of Houston.
Hotbed of softball.
Yeah, it is. She's hitting 385 at the bottom of the order. One driven in. 5 for 13. They've all been singles. And she scored 6 times.
Jerry Glasgow says she has great bat control.
Newland, Briggs, and Rudity in the outfield, playing this hitter as a slightly opposite field swinger. Coffey and Pleasance on the left side of the diamond. Petty and Gutierrez on the right side. Bergeron is catching. Two balls and a strike. Chafin windmills at home. Off the mark, and Chafin kind of did a double take.
Chafin's got that slow wind up, and all of a sudden it's real quick getting to the plate. Kind of almost lulls you to sleep, and then boom.
3 balls and a strike. That's downstairs. The pitch before that was borderline. That one was clearly off the mark. And Falterman is aboard. That's the first walk from Chafin, but it puts the leadoff batter on base. And back to the top of the order we go for the very swift Maya Davis.
Falterman is 3-for-3 in stolen bases. Just said Jerry hadn't been running a lot this year. Let's see what happens.
Well, Davis in only two games is 6-for-6 in stolen bases. Gutierrez throws it by, and Petty can't handle it. Runners wind up at second and third. It would have been an extremely close play at first base, but Petty never really was able to find that ball. Not sure whether the throw was out of her reach.
I think it went into the runner.
Or whether she was just blocked by the runner. We'll take a look here.
I'm pretty sure that would happen. As you said, it probably was going to be a base hit, but look.
Well, the throw was also in
foul
ground,
it appeared.
It was
on the other side of the runner. Cajuns definitely have something cooking here.
Berzon is warming up for LSU. I don't know if this discussion is about perhaps the base runner in the running lane or not.
I was just about to say, if we could see that again to see if they have a question about that, although they could be stalling a little bit also to have Berzon warm up. And they are going to look at it on the headset.
So there's something that's debatable, at least, or replayable. Let's take a look at one angle we have of this. Where is the base runner?
Oh, she's on the line, on the line, on the line.
That's legal. I think that's legal. But they will take another look at it.
Yeah, it's not a great throw. Otherwise, Perry could have gone to the outside, like getting foul territory to receive that ball, but it's a ball that I think is just chunked away.
Now, there's no question that throw, as we looked at it two or three times, that throw is unreachable by Petty.
And we, in glowing terms for Gutierrez at first base, she's usually on the money, but that ball just got away from her.
But they will look, apparently, to try to determine the positioning of the base runner. Was she outside the runner's lane? And they may be looking at her foot in the batter's box as well. Now, you see that double stripe halfway, which starts halfway toward first base. You've got to be between those two stripes on your way to first base at the end of the play.
On the line. Let's see if she's out of the box here.
I don't think so. No. I think that's clean.
And the ball didn't touch her.
That's clean.
It's a great job.
Now, do we have a batter outside the batter's running lane? I think that's okay.
Yeah, she's on the line. I mean, really on the line, which is okay.
And I don't know that this will take a whole lot of time, but we'll wait and see what the officials decide. The umpires signal no foul. Everybody's safe.
And I think Beth Tarina might have did this challenge to stall also a little bit to get her bullpen ready.
That's going to go as an infield hit and a throwing error.
And she's making a change.
So Chafin's day is done in the third. Berzon will come out of the bullpen. She has been the most frequent pitcher for the Tigers this year. Chafin out, Berzon in. We'll take a timeout and be right back. The Cajuns are threatening to break open a 2-2 game. Sidney Berzon, who has burst on the scene as a rookie pitcher, is making her ninth appearance. She's 5-0. An ERA of 0.27, 26 innings of work, 24 strikeouts, 8 walks. And Sidney Berzon has been a very reliable pitcher, both as a starter and coming out of the bullpen.
Three saves already. Beth Tarina just gushes when she talks about Berzon, just waiting for this freshman to arrive. Probably committed a couple of years ago, New York native that went to boarding school in Chattanooga for 4 years and played for a former Tiger in summer ball.
Berzon has allowed 17 hits in those innings of work. Maddie Hayden at the plate. The Cajuns have a chance to take the lead. Hayden flied to left field last time.
Berzon's best pitch is her drop ball, which is what you'd want in this situation.
That's a strike in the lower part of the zone.
Of course, Bergeron has to be a wall behind the plate.
Here's the 1-1 pitch to Hayden. She goes up to get it and flicks it foul.
She has many pitches, speed, and movement. She can throw different pitches at different speeds.
Nobody out. A pair of runners in scoring position. And Beth Tarina has a question for the plate umpire, Lyndon Baptiste.
Not sure what it is. Of course, the Tiger infield is pulled in.
Hayden has a slightly split grip. The 1-2 pitch. Fouled away, and that one might have gotten the foot of the young catcher, Bergeron. And she's going to walk that off. I think that hit her on the right toe, maybe. Maybe the knee.
Hit something, because she's walking it off. You saw her kind of collapse a little bit. And you talked about not a lot of depth behind the plate as the Tigers have lost. Looks like it got that knee. Lost a Hannah Carson, who was projected to be a catcher, and he's out for the season.
Got Solnick is on deck. Hayden has spoiled a few pitches.
So you've seen Berzon go up and go down.
And back to Carson just for the moment. We reported this last night, but she is out for the year, as you mentioned, Yvette, with the ACL injury, the tear. The good news is she has been declared eligible to play next year if she wishes.
And there's that drop ball for the strikeout.
That is a huge strikeout. Berzon comes on and fans Hayden. That's only the first out. First base is open for Kotzelnik as she comes to the plate. Let's see how the Tiger infield plays this. It will remain squeezed toward the dish.
And what a luxury to have a drop ball pitcher in this situation. You want the ball to stay on the infield.
She would really relish another strikeout here.
It's a wild pitch. Safe.
Safe at the plate. And I think that call, even though it was close,
it's correct.
From our angle, it did look correct.
Absolutely correct. I thought the play was going to be closer than it was because it had a good bounce off of the backstop. But, yep, that leg gets in there. Safe right there. Anybody else that doesn't have any kind of speed probably doesn't beat that out.
Well, you talked about Falterman's speed, and she demonstrated it then. This ball is hit high. It's hit deep. Will it stay in the ballpark? No, it will not. A home run for Stormy Kotzelnik. And the Cajuns have come alive here. They have come from a 2-0 deficit to take the lead. Two in the second for the Cajuns, and three more in the third. Second home run of the season for Kotzelnik.
Well, they can hit. And they proved that last week when they just kept coming back and back and back.
After the wild pitch, scored a run, Kotzelnik hits the 2-run home run just out of the reach of Rudity, who climbed the ladder in right field but couldn't pull it back. And these Cajuns have a three-run lead now. Here's Jordan Campbell with the bases empty, one out, and some damage done by the team from Lafayette. Campbell grounded out to Coffey last time. Very few times this year has LSU trailed in a game. But right now, trailing in the third, 5-2, giving up a pair in the second, and three in the third.
I don't think they've trailed when we're doing the games.
Not when we're doing it,
remember that.
But they did trail on a couple of occasions.
Sure.
And Yvette, when you go back and look at the second inning, it was a hit batter, which extended the inning, and in this frame, it was a leadoff walk.
Always gets you in trouble. And it got the Cajuns in trouble in the first inning.
There's a strike. And Campbell is retired for the second out. Berzon has pitched to three batters. She's fanned a couple of them, and she gave up a two-run home run to Kotzelnik. Here's Carly Heath, who was hit by a pitch and scored in the second. Chafin started. She pitched into the third inning.
So to be a tough play here.
And Petty wisely puts that in her pocket after she made the pickup in front of second base, an infield hit for Heath.
Heath just uses the ground to her advantage, pounds that ball down, and once it goes over on that big hop, nobody's making this play here. Base paths are too close in this game.
60 feet. Late swing and a miss, throw down, not in time. Taylor Pleasance goes down in a heap.
Bergeron trying to frame that ball a little too long, I think.
Longaliers popped up to Petty last time.
Just holding that pitch and the runner's going.
Here's the 0-1, off speed and a good one.
Beautiful changeup.
One pitch lined into right field. Rudity comes up throwing to the plate. Here comes
what a throw.
And she is out.
What a throw.
And they're going to try to challenge this. UL appears to maybe have a case. That was a tremendous throw.
Tremendous slide.
But did the tag get the base runner? I'm not sure. There was contact. The officials are going to look at it. It'll be the second review of this inning.
It was an unbelievably athletic slide. You thought she was out the entire way. We talk about how Rudity has a cannon out there. Watch this throw.
Rudity uncorks it in the air.
Let's see here. Oh, she might have got her in the face.
Perhaps, but there was an angle that appeared to show some space between the glove and the body.
And she comes up saying, put the headset on.
Hang with you right here.
We'd have to be able to see a few views of this.
This is really a huge decision. Is it the third out or is it the fourth run of the inning? That was a brilliant release from Rudity in right field.
And a brilliant slide. Don't tell me these players aren't athletic. If she got her on the face.
If she got her on the helmet or the side of the face.
She's out.
That is correct. Is there contact here? Because not yet has the runner reached the plate. There's the contact with the dish. I don't know that there's enough to overturn it. Do you?
And I tell you, Blue took his time because I think he was about to say safe, but he took his time to make that call. tough call, you know, without instant replay.
So we'll wait for the umpires to make a decision here after looking at all of the available replay evidence. And the call stands. It is an out at the plate. So Rudity guns down a runner at the plate to end the inning. But a three-run uprising for the Cajuns, and there's a 5-2 lead for the visitors as we go to the bottom of the third. Five runs, four hits, no errors. Louisiana, the last couple of frames, finding the scoreboard. LSU with two in the first, but trails by three. And it's Briggs, it's Pleasance, it's Clark. In the bottom of the third against the starter, Megan Shorman, who was reached for a walk and an RBI double and an RBI single in the first inning, but has settled in a bit since then.
Settled in big time.
Briggs had a sacrifice bunt last time. She's on a four-game hitting streak.
That's a base hit.
Safe on a very close play. Briggs is just too swift home to first. And when that ball even hesitates or takes a second bounce on the dirt, it gives Briggs the advantage.
Well, she does so many things correct with the bat that you have to give her a little. And this is a heck of a play by Hayden, but she's just so fast.
And you're right. Maddie Hayden did everything she could from third base. You can't play it any better than that.
And you got to give her a little bit of room there because Briggs handles the bat as well as anybody in the country.
So Briggs with a five-game hitting streak and the 20th base hit of the season for Briggs. That's a team-leading number now. And this brings on Pleasance, who had an RBI double in the first. Pleasance has knocked in more runs this year than any player in the nation. She's got 24 RBI. That's a pitch Taylor might want to see again.
Absolutely.
You could tell she flinched a little bit and then laid off of it. But Shorman may have gotten away with one. Clark is on deck. This is the meat and potatoes part of the order. That's a good pitch by Shorman.
That's as good a screwball as you can throw. Right there at the knees. This is where both pitchers need their changeups to work.
Pleasance rests the bat on her shoulder. Then she picks it up a couple of inches. The pitch upstairs. Some hitters would have chased that. Pleasance did not.
I was just going to say, that's how well Pleasance sees the ball. I would say 90% of the hitters would have swung at that pitch.
There is very little wind right now. What there is blowing from right to left, essentially. Pleasance waves through one. Not often does she strike out swinging.
Well, she's got that screwball working now, and we talk about it all the time. Just a tough pitch for lefties to hit. Look where this pitch ends up.
You got to tip your cap to the pitcher, Megan Shorman, on that delivery.
Absolutely. Not all about the hitter sometimes.
Here's Georgia Clark, who had an RBI single. A quick to the left field wall RBI single last time. The pitch is outside, ball one.
Cajuns get out of this without giving up a run. This is a big inning here because Tigers have the potential to score runs quickly.
LSU has won five straight games in this crossover tournament over the last few years against the Cajuns. They will play tomorrow in Lafayette.
And there's that changeup.
Briggs on her way. She picked a good pitch on which to run, didn't she?
I tell you, I'm thinking that maybe Beth Tarina picked it. She's very good at picking pitches, and because you're three runs down.
She is the leading base stealer for the Tigers with five.
Not a great throw. Tried to throw it from her knees, which about the only chance she has with Briggs' speed.
The 1-1 to Clark. That got a little piece of the front part of the outside plate.
And she uses her curveball to throw outside to the righties. And she's got both sides of the plate working now. That it woke up.
And that pitch was just a little nipper. Got the front part of the plate on the corner. Might have been caught outside, but it was a strike when it first got to the dish.
And then tried to come back inside and jam her. So her pitches are starting to wake up here.
And the radar gun has indicated the last pitch was 67 miles an hour. That's pretty much in the upper part of the speed across the country. Here's the 2-2, a big pitch coming, the make it happen pitch. Briggs at second base, one out. High and
goodbye.
Deep. Way back. Way back. Is that caught? Oh, my goodness. A remarkable play in center field.
It's going to be a double play.
A remarkable play in center field by Maya Davis. She is hurt, moving a little bit now, but an extraordinary play. Absolutely unbelievable.
I thought that ball was out of here. And is it a double play?
A phenomenal, never-before-seen type catch by the center fielder Maya Davis.
Talking about her leg.
This is beyond belief, the catch in center field.
I think she's okay. I think she was stunned. But
wow.
What a catch.
Wow, wow, wow. Can you believe that?
That's a ESPN highlight play for sure. I thought that ball was out of here. Let's see this play. Look at, she just never gives up on this ball. Wow.
Head first.
Ooh, head first into
head
the wall.
Head first into the wall. She holds onto the ball apparently. Absolutely incredible. I've never seen anything better than that. Never.
And thank God that's a padded wall. And that's why the NCAA has gone to, these walls have to be safe. The red Cajun wall is now gone in Lafayette. It's a black padded wall now. That's got to make the ESPN highlight reel.
I don't think they're going to take
this,
any chances
how
with
her. How is this not a double play? Because I'm pretty sure Briggs didn't tag.
Well, we'll sort that part out right now.
Is that Georgia Clark standing on second? I mean, she's out.
So evidently we're going to have some additional discussion here about the outcome of the play. Remember, Briggs was at second base when Clark drove it to the wall. And Yvette, we have seen a lot of diamond sports. That may be the best catch ever that I have witnessed.
It would rank in my top whatever's. Seen some balls stolen over the wall, but to be full out, bang your head into the fence. And this is from a girl who just came back from injury. Don't tell me that these girls are soft.
Maya Davis could have driven a nail into the wall with her head. I mean, that was unreal. And they're going to look at all of this and sort it out. They can go back and try to see who was where, when the catch was made. Was the catch made? This, we're not done yet with the final rendering of this play.
I just off the top of my head, I just don't see how Briggs tagged. Maybe she did, but
that would have been great base running if she did, because obviously if it was a home run, she was going to score anyway. But even if it wasn't a home run, she's going to score from second base probably. So, you know, that would have been.
What kind of speed does Maya Davis have? She just turned on those jets.
Just incredible
just
what we've just seen.
Track that ball down anywhere else. If she hits that ball 5 feet left, that ball's out of here. And I really thought it was out. But she kind of hit it to the deepest part of the park almost.
Let's take a look at this again. That's Briggs leading off. Okay, now, she tagged.
She did tag. Good base running.
Now, Clark is digging for second base. She doesn't know that the ball has been caught. And then the umpire calls Clark safe, but if the ball were caught. Now, Briggs, meanwhile, just kept running,
and which she can do, of course.
We
think she tagged. We don't know where she was on the base when the ball was caught. She should have scored.
And I think it's going to settle out
right.
Like this. A catch,
and it's
the likes of which you have never seen before.
And it's two outs with a run for LSU.
And then the legal tag and the score from second base by Briggs.
What a crazy play. Wait a minute. Are they saying she didn't tag? Because the Cajuns just got excited. That's what I said. She did tag.
We don't know.
We don't know if she tagged because we didn't see when the ball was catched and where Briggs was. We just saw Briggs.
Briggs clearly tagged. Did she leave early?
That's what I'm saying.
Well, apparently it is a double play. So we'll move on. Wow. What we have just seen is almost beyond description. 5-2, Louisiana leads LSU. Well, during the timeout, our production crew has done some tremendous work to verify what the umpires have ruled. This is synced up. You see the catch in center field. You see Briggs, who has left. She went back to tag, but she left prematurely before that catch. Surely she was thinking that ball was not going to be snared out there against the wall. And she was a step and a half away from second base, having left early with the catch being made. So, Yvette, that is indisputable video evidence, and congratulations to our replay guys
and all
the folks in the production room making that happen.
Our guys, what a job. But it just goes to show, I mean, without that kind of evidence, umpires might not get that right. That'd be a very tough call.
But I will say it again. That is the best catch I have ever seen. Maya Davis, headlong into the wall and holding on. Wow.
And Berzon not quite sharp here. Full straight pitches for balls.
Valdez.
Talk about the big momentum has just switched.
Valdez, after the home run in the second inning, is now at first. And here is Vasquez. Well, we may have a pinch hitter.
Taylor Roman.
Taylor Roman, a first baseman outfielder, hitting for the Cajuns. Roman is 2-for-5 on the year with one driven in, a big right-handed batter.
Ton of power. Ben Kurt, her career, came on as a freshman and was just, you know, outstanding, but it's kind of lived with injury since then.
The Cajuns lead it 5-2.
What a big inning that was for the Cajuns to get out of that jam. I mean, if that's not the ESPN highlight play.
That's the best you'll see for a while, if not ever. Two strikes on Roman. She lays off the rise ball.
Always something crazy in this series.
Roman stepped toward third base as she took that swing, and she taps it foul at the plate. Roman's two hits have been singles. 1-2 pitch. Dribbled toward Pleasant. She makes a backhanded flip, and it's dug out by Petty. That was a really nice reaction by the second baseman to get that off-balance flip.
Yeah, it was awkward from Pleasance all around. I thought maybe it was a chance to get a double play here, but she comes up on his ball, then she backs up, and then it just gets stuck in her hand, and good job by Petty to salvage that.
That's a great word for it, salvage that play for an out.
Yeah, because it was
iffy.
Potential going in the center field. The batted ball.
Here's Falterman, who has walked and scored. We play in the fourth of an action-packed game. Five runs, four hits, no errors, and a spectacular play in center field from Maya Davis. That's the total for the Cajuns. Two runs, three hits, one error for LSU.
Great looking changeup there that matches that drop ball, and the slapper's just running through that pitch.
Davis is scheduled to hit next, and indeed she is in the on-deck circle. So apparently they checked her out, and she's been cleared to continue after running headlong. The crown of her head made contact with the wall at full speed.
It's going to be a tough play.
Out on a very nice play by third baseman Coffey in the stretch by Gutierrez. Davis comes to the plate. Let's look at her defensively. On the run, on the run. Tracking, diving, and then driving her head into the wall. She makes the catch on the backhand side as she leaves the ground, and the crown of her head is the first to make contact with that wall. Now she's at the plate. Chops it toward Coffey. Gonna have to quick release it, and does so. Back to back. Guns by Coffey. Coffey displayed at third base.
Great job by Coffey both times. I thought maybe. Nope, I think he's asking. Nope, he's not.
We'll take a break here. It's 5-2. The Cajuns lead LSU. Five to two is our score as the Tigers will try to change the scoreboard in the bottom of the fourth inning. LSU trailing the Raging Cajuns, who scored two in the second and three in the third. LSU got out in front 2-0 in the first, but nothing since then. And here is Mackenzie Rudity against the Raging Cajun starter, Megan Shorman. Rudity lifts the first pitch out of play.
Shorman is truly settled down since that first inning.
The pitch to Rudity is tight, 2-0.
How good has this game been, Lynn? Golly.
The count 1-1, and Rudity swings through that one. It's 1-2. Yeah, we've seen a whole lot in a short period of time, have we not?
Yeah, I mean, it looked all LSU in that first inning, and the Cajuns have just roared back.
One ball, two strikes. Rudity leading it off in the bottom of the fourth.
Tigers made a crucial error, and then the Cajuns bombs away, and then just an unbelievable defensive play. So game
has turned. And then Coffey comes back and makes two superb plays.
Game turned on a dime.
A bootlegger's turn. Here's the 2-2 to Rudity. LSU needs base runners. Rudity spoils one. LSU will play again tonight after this game, and that will be against Texas A&M Corpus Christi. And then tomorrow, LSU will go to Lafayette, make the hour run across the Atchafalaya Basin, and play at 2:30 Central Time tomorrow in Lafayette. Ruderdy can't lay off the high pitch. That was probably out of the strike zone.
Well, she gets to use that big movement because she works ahead. And then here's this big rise ball out of the zone on the outside corner. But the ball is moving through the zone. That's the key.
Five strikeouts now for Shoreman. Ruderdy has gone down twice. Here's Petty, who flied to left field last time. The left fielder backs up a step or two. Strike one to Petty. That wind has shifted a bit. It's now blowing toward the plate.
I don't know what it was doing when Clark hit that shot.
There you see the flags. Kind of swirling a little. Now a little right to left, but mostly toward the plate now. The off-speed pitch clips the inside part of the plate.
Well, you see the flags that are hidden, well, in back of the performance center in the indoor center. You can see where that's where you need to hit the home run balls from right center to right field. Those flags just standing still. That big building blocking the wind.
Mm-hmm. The Mike Moore Performance Center, one of the leading buildings and facilities in the country for enhancing softball skills, an indoor facility. It's got a complete indoor infield with carpet in that facility, as well as pitching and hitting cages.
Weight room.
You don't miss a day now because of bad weather, do you?
Nope. Players know. You get that one day off, and that's about it.
Carly Petty out of Moore, Oklahoma.
Transfer from Oklahoma State.
Petty checks her swing. And the home plate umpire recognizes that and calls her out. That's six strikeouts now. You know, you mentioned Oklahoma State, which kind of segues into what this Southeastern Conference schedule is going to look like when Oklahoma and Texas join the league. And I surely hope they go to a 30-game SEC schedule like baseball has right now. 24 to me is just not enough.
Wow, what a schedule that will be.
Oh, it will be.
That's a war every weekend.
That's what it should be.
Oh, hung on.
That ball was bobbled a little bit, but the play is made. 4-3 on the putout. 1-2-3 go the Tigers in the fourth. We move to the fifth inning. The Raging Cajuns 5, LSU 2. Five to two. The Raging Cajuns have the lead over the Tigers. Top of the fifth inning coming your way on the SEC ESPN Network. And what an action-packed game we have seen so far. Berzon in the circle. She came on in the third inning in relief of Raylan Chafin.
We've had a little bit of a rough go here, though, so far. Still with all of the weapons, you have to learn the pitch on this level.
Berzon to Maddie Hayden. Strike one. Watch the split grip that Hayden uses. She'll have an inch or so between the hands.
She can fly.
She chokes up about an inch and then has a split grip. The King of the Sun Belt Conference, taking on the LSU Tigers out of the SEC.
Danica Coffey's getting a workout over there.
Yes, she is, and she has responded favorably each time. Hayden is 0 for 3. Coffey has 5 assists from third base already in this game.
Now, Carmel, Indiana, you've got to believe that it's Jerry Glasgow's connections since he's from Illinois.
Nick has grounded out and has a two-run home run.
Since Nick is from Indiana. She committed to Washington at 13 years old.
Wow. Most 13-year-olds don't know where Washington is.
You can't even drive yet.
Burrs on to the plate. Two balls and a strike, one out. The bases are empty. This will be a chance for Gutierrez. She'll make it herself. And there are two down.
Not a lot of hits in this ball game so far, Lynn. The Cajuns have 4, Tigers 3.
Right,
the Cajuns very opportunistic with that big home run. Scored 5 runs. How pretty is that pitch?
And Yvette, I think we have shorted the Cajuns on one hit. The scoreboard here, I think, is a hit behind.
Okay.
So I've got 5 on my sheet, and some other sheets have 5 as well. Let's call it 5 hits at the moment.
Okay.
But you were not reading it incorrectly. The scoreboard apparently is a hit behind.
You do see the weapons that this freshman has. She has that just devastating changeup on that first pitch, comes inside with that screwball.
Jordan Campbell at the plate, 2 outs, nobody on base, 1 ball, 1 strike. The Louisiana right fielder with a ground out to third and a strikeout. This is the second time she has faced Burzon. Chafin pitched into the third. And then Burzon, after a walk and a base hit in the third inning, came on, and she's been there since. The 3-1 pitch. Lined into the right field corner. That'll go for a base hit.
How about that inside-out swing?
Ruderdy gets it back to second base, but you're right, a really nice job of putting the bat on the ball.
Stays in tight, muscles that ball out to right field.
And Campbell will be lifted apparently for a pinch runner.
Pinch runner from Cajuns now at first base, number 10, Kramer Ushtay. Ushtay, new runner for the Cajuns.
Ushtay is the runner.
Number 7, Carly Heath.
Kramer Ushtay.
Carly Heath, the hitter, second on the team with RBIs.
The runner is moving, the batter is swinging, and it's fouled away.
Number
Eshete is spelled E-S-C-H-E-T-E and pronounced Eshete. Heath has been hit by a pitch, and she scored on a two-out, two-run home run by Valdez. And in her second at-bat, she singled and was later thrown out at third base.
That's a dangerous hitter. She's... Oh, what had happened here? Did we leave first base early? That could be the only call that it would be.
So the runner is declared out, and it's the third out of the inning. The Tigers get back to the dugout, and we'll step aside for a moment. The Ragin' Cajuns have a three-run lead on the LSU Tigers as we move forward in Tiger Park. Let's take a look at Kramer Eshete. She was ruled out for leaving prematurely, and clearly does. So she is well away from the bag by the time the ball is released, and that was a proper call by the first base umpire. And we had video evidence once again put together by our crew in our production studio. We thank them immensely for that.
Got to have the same lead on every pitch.
Bergeron rolls it to the shortstop, and it is a throw in the dirt that cannot be picked up. Bergeron is aboard. LSU needs every base runner it can get. Trailing by three.
Yeah, just didn't have enough on that throw. It just kind of shot put it over there.
So that'll be a throwing error. Oh, they've ruled an error on the first baseman?
I don't know.
Can't do that with a ball in the dirt.
Well.
No. But it'll be an error. Bergeron is aboard. That's clearly a bad throw.
Yeah, but if you're supposed to be a first baseman, aren't you supposed to, like, catch those? Supposed to catch everything.
If you think that's a reasonable opportunity, which is what the...
Oh, I'd want my first baseman.
Oh, well, there's no doubt you'd want him to catch it. And we'll have a pinch
runner. Oh, it's a bad throw, no question, but...
We'll have a pinch runner, too. Gutierrez is going to come to the plate. And it has been ruled a throwing error on the shortstop. And so E6. And Madeline Giglio is going to run.
So the errors are evened up here.
Let's see if LSU can take advantage of the free base runner. Pitch is outside, ball one.
Tigers' error was very costly.
Yes, it was. Gutierrez out of Upland, California. She's a junior. Walked last time. LSU down by three in the bottom of the fifth. That hits Gutierrez, and now the tying run comes to the plate. And this is where it starts to get a little dicey.
Absolutely. Kind of opening the door a little bit.
And Cajun pitching has not been able to do much with the 250 hitting Gutierrez. She walked and she's been hit by a pitch. So she at the bottom of the order has been on twice. Nobody out. Two aboard. Here's Coffey. She has walked and scored and fly to center. Briggs is next, and Pleasance is after her.
And this is where the Tigers do most of their damage.
Shorman has hit four batters this year.
I was wondering how long this would take for a trip to the circle.
Well, we've got conferences everywhere. All three outfielders are kneeled in center field on the Tiger Eye logo. The whole infield plus the pitching coach is in the circle. And there are four offensive LSU Tigers along with all three coaches huddled up as well around the mound. Wow. There's a lot of palaver going on right now.
Palaver? It There's a lot of cascara going around, too.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. LSU, after the first inning, is only 1-for-10 of it. And you mentioned it, that Shoreman has the clear ability to settle in, and she has. Now, she's in trouble now with the water starting to boil around her. But 2-for-4 in the first inning and virtually nothing since then for the Tigers.
Oh, no, she's pitched very well since the first inning.
There's a strike poured right down Main Street.
Now, Coffey's very capable of slapping this ball right down past Hayden. You'll see the Cajun corners just crashing.
Gilio at second. Gutierrez on first. Good speed on the base paths for LSU. That's a ball that levels the count.
You don't see this too much anymore where the corners are in the faces of the hitters.
Yeah.
That used to be a common place where they were about 5 feet away.
Well, they could shake hands with each other in the old days, the batter and the defenders. The 1-1 pitch. Swung on, lifted into foul territory. There may be a play, and there is. That's taken in foul ground by Falterman, and the runners cannot advance.
And that is a big out for the Cajuns, and Coffey elected to go for a rise ball and popped it up.
So now here's the leading hit producer on the season for LSU in Sierra Briggs, the second of four consecutive 400 hitters. 2 on, 1 out. Coffey fouls out to Falterman in left field. As good as Briggs has been with the bat in her hand this year, and she's been among the very best in the country, it's a little bit surprising she's only hitting 250 with runners in scoring position.
Having a tough day today.
She has managed to leg out an infield hit and a sacrifice bunt. And that's a good pitch from Shoreman. One ball, one strike, one out, 2 on. LSU trails 5-2. Pleasance is on deck.
Shoreman continues to follow the pattern of trying to stay outside with that screwball and then move that ball through the zone at the rise. It's been very effective.
Briggs is on a 5-game hitting streak. And this will wind up foul out of play on the left side.
Shoreman has really settled down since that first inning.
Oh, she really has.
She couldn't find the zone at all. And now
she's been very efficient since then. At the very least, LSU is hoping to get Pleasance at the plate with two aboard because she would represent the tying run.
And that's why that first out was so monumental for the Cajuns.
The 2-2. Rammed and slicing foul deep in the left field corner.
Just keep thinking about Maya Davis's catch, which could have potentially been disastrous, just health-wise is what I'm talking about. I mean, she could have broke her neck. Thank God it's a padded wall.
I have a feeling we might see that play once or twice in the next couple of days.
Well, I just can't believe if it's not going to be the ESPN highlight play.
2-2 pitch lifted over the roof.
Lynn, I'll have you know that all the first basemen are texting me saying she should have picked that ball.
Well, she should have, but the throw should have been out of the dirt, too. But I agree with you. It's catchable. E6, though. 2-2 pitch. Hit to left. Balterman is able to backpedal and make the play. She was battling the sun. She started in a step or two and then retreated quickly enough to get to it.
Tough part of the day for all the left side of the field. Saw she almost got burnt there. She came in on that ball and then backpedaled quick, like you said.
So now it's Pleasance with two outs. Gilio is the pinch runner at second base. Gutierrez is behind her. Pleasance, the leading RBI producer in the country, has an RBI double in the game, and she struck out swinging last time. She's a 478 hitter with runners in scoring position. Boy, that's a number that really speaks for itself, doesn't it?
You got to be really careful because then Clark, you know, is up next, and she missed a home run by inches. So Shoreman gets out of this inning, she'll have dodged a huge bullet. May not have to see these hitters again.
We are in the fifth inning. There will be no play on this foul ball. The Cajuns and the Tigers. One of the best softball rivalries in the land. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Can Pleasance even the score with a swing? That's high and tight. She's turned away.
.478 batting average with runners in scoring position. Team USA player.
Two outs, two on. The 2-1 pitch. Ooh, Pleasance with a good swing, but was under that ball a bit. Now the make it happen pitch at 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 out, 2 on. A 3-run deficit in the fifth inning for LSU.
I'm thinking you throw a changeup here in the dirt. You leave it short. Just can't keep throwing the same speed.
Let's see if she has that in her arsenal right here at 2-2. Megan Shoreman to Taylor Pleasance.
I think she tried.
And we'll do it again.
Good battle here.
Indeed it is. These are the moments for which you come out to the ballpark, right?
And the moments you want to be at the plate and in the circle. Got to welcome the pressure.
The 2-2 again. Ground ball right side, bobbled for the moment, picked up and then shoveled over by Langoliers to Kotzelnik, and this inning is over. Tigers get the first two aboard, but leave them there as Megan Shoreman is equal to the task. We move on. It's 5-2. Louisiana leading LSU. Top of the sixth inning coming your way from Tiger Park on the campus of LSU. The Raging Cajuns fell behind 2-0 in the first, but they have scored 2 in the second and 3 in the third, and they have seen an absolutely unbelievably tremendous play in center field by Maya Davis. And here we go in the sixth inning.
Potentially, if it stands here, potentially was a game-saving catch because you're
just
gonna
incredible.
Score two.
Heath at the plate. She's had a good day. She's been hit by a pitch and scored, and she has an infield hit. The bet, are you ready from scores from around the SEC?
Well, I am.
Tennessee, boy, this is an old-fashioned pitcher's duel. 1-0. Ooh. Number 9 Tennessee over number 5 Clemson. 1-0.
The way the game used to be.
And Tennessee will play Illinois-Chicago a little later. Alabama 14-4 over Indiana State. That's ruled a foul ball. And Alabama has also defeated Southeastern Louisiana 11-0. So 14-4 and 11-0, a pair of wins for Bama. Stephen F. Austin beat Ole Miss 3-1.
There's, I believe, an upset.
And Ole Miss and McNeese are about to do battle.
And I actually called the Cajuns and Ole Miss on Monday night in Lafayette.
Florida failed to score. It was beaten by Oregon 8-0. And Florida is trailing Fullerton 3-1 in the sixth inning. So if Florida doesn't win that game, that would be their third loss in a row.
They've had a rough couple of days.
Arkansas has knocked off Drake 7-2. Mississippi State beat Louisiana Tech 8-4. And Mississippi State will take on Furman a little later. Georgia shut out California Baptist 9-0. And Hofstra is the next opponent today for Georgia. Auburn will play North Dakota State and Merrimack today. We have no scores from Auburn yet.
Where's Merrimack? Maryland? You mean you don't know? I stumped you?
I'm guessing New York. Out at first base.
I think it's one of those New England states.
Missouri and Oregon will play later, and Missouri and Long Beach State will also play. Massachusetts is what I meant to say, not New York.
Didn't I say that?
You might have. I was thinking Massachusetts. I said New York, but it's in Massachusetts.
Did I say Maryland? I don't even know.
You
it's
did.
One of those M's.
You did. But we both meant Massachusetts, right? South Carolina takes on Tennessee Tech later. Texas A&M and number one UCLA get together, and then Utah Valley will play Texas A&M. And then tonight it's Kentucky and UC Riverside. You're up to date in action involving the Southeastern Conference. Langoliers, a sophomore from Keller, Texas.
Keller, Texas, that's where Kirsten Shortridge is from.
She of the all-time highest career batting average at LSU, Shortridge. Langoliers has popped up to second and singled. Briggs backs up and makes the play a step or two in front of the wall. Briggs is so good at reading the ball off the bat. And there is no wasted motion when she puts it in gear and engages the ball coming off the bat.
She's tracked it down perfectly. We've seen some nice plays out there in the outfield.
Here's Valdez, who has homered and walked. She had a two-run home run to tie the game in the second inning, ball one.
And she really gave the Cajuns back some momentum because Tigers jumped all over them in the first inning, 2-0. And with that shot, and they didn't particularly look that good, but with that shot, she brought them right back into the game.
Let's go back and take a look at it a bit.
And that's a good piece of hitting. That's a screwball that's probably a little bit too much over the plate, but kind of in her knees, so not that bad a pitch. Tip your hat to the hitter.
Since then, it's been all Cajuns. And LSU bats have gone silent since the first inning.
Yeah, they only have 3 hits on the day so far.
And one of them coming after the first inning. One hit over the last 4 frames for LSU against Megan Shoreman.
Just shows you how much Shoreman really just settled down.
Here's Coffey with another assist attempt. She's got 6 throwouts from third base. A three up, three down inning. LSU shuts down the Cajun Cajuns in the sixth, but trails 5-2. After surrendering two runs in the first, Megan Shorman has thrown four consecutive shutout innings against the LSU Tigers.
Well, she looked, you see her painting corners here, using that ball that just moves through the zone. Low rises, high rises. She just has settled down after that first inning.
And a bet, she threw more than 30 pitches in the first inning, but since then has been much more efficient.
Yeah, she couldn't get in any kind of groove there in that first inning, but I don't know if she found it when she went back into the dugout, maybe went back in the bullpen and threw a few more. That's what I would suggest sometimes, and she's been lights out since then.
Here's Clark, ball one wide.
Just kind of yanked that curveball there.
Georgia is 1-for-2. She homered last night, her third of the year. Batting well above 400. That's outside two.
Comes back with that same pitch. Misses again. Not as much, but still missed.
Clark belts it high, belts it deep. You can pucker up and kiss that baby goodbye.
I think that was a changeup by Shorman that just kind of hung there. And
a berm bomb for Georgia Clark, her fourth home run of the year, her second in as many games, and the Tigers get one back.
And she is trying to fire up those Tigers. She hits this in a different spot. And she hit the previous one. Like I said, that she'd have hit, you know, she hit that ball to the biggest part of the park a while ago, but I'm pretty sure that was a changeup that just hung there.
Well, that's two balls she has blistered in her last two at-bats. Tigers down by two, though.
That just shows you how big that inning was before.
No question.
With two runners on with nobody out.
Here's Ruderdeet. She's first pitch swinging, and this one will not be playable. Ruderdeet has not yet seemed comfortable against Shorman. Shorman has struck her out twice and induced her to swing at balls that were not in the strike zone.
Absolutely, you're correct there. She has swung at pitcher's pitches. Jerry Glasgow has kind of a quick hook. So far, Shorman has been brilliant, but don't be surprised if she gives up another hit if he makes a change.
Ruderdeet falls behind 0-2.
She's at 100 pitches, which only means she's thrown more than she needs to. These girls can throw all day long if they had to.
Petty is on deck.
See, in that first inning, she wasn't close with that screwball that just kind of rides away from those lefties, and now she's just barely missing.
The 1-2 pitch to Mackenzie Ruderdeet. Lobbed out toward left center, and that's down for a base hit. It was beyond the reach of the backpedaling shortstop. It was in front of the oncoming Falterman in left field. And LSU with a home run and a blooper. And now the tying run comes to the plate.
And sometimes you gotta have a little bit of luck on your side too. The ball has to have eyes.
Here's Carly Petty. She has flied to left and struck out.
And we do see some action in the bullpen for the Cajuns.
If you're thinking home run, Carly Petty does not have one in the early going. She is first pitch swinging. And I don't think there will be a play. There is not. You know what's amazing of that as we just roar through the first couple of weeks of the season. After tomorrow, about 25% of the season will be gone already for the Tigers, just 2 weeks into it.
Tigers start conference play next weekend, correct?
Let's check that.
Could be wrong.
Starts on the 11th of March.
So what's next weekend?
A tournament.
Where?
Couldn't tell you.
Well, it's
Michigan, Loyola Marymount, Minnesota, San Jose State, Cal Poly.
Well, it's right around the corner.
Yeah, it is. And there aren't a whole lot of midweek games after conference starts.
Well, it's tough to play midweek when she played Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Where is that tournament? I mean, LSU has got
Michigan. It's California.
Michigan, Loyola, yes, it is in California. Michigan, Loyola Marymount, Minnesota, San Jose State, Cal Poly, all in a row in that tournament. And then at South Carolina. So LSU will be going from one side of the country to the other.
You're right.
11th, 12th, and 13th of March is the first SEC action. And, of course, all three of those games will be on the SEC Network. LSU at South Carolina. The first home SEC series is the 17th, 18th, and 19th when Tennessee comes to town. Ground ball right side. The sure out is made at first base as Petty is retired by her counterpart, Alexa Langoliers. Rudy moved up to scoring position, and here's an RBI opportunity for Allie Newland, who has walked and grounded to second base.
I was thinking that was a double play opportunity. I was not quite sure why she didn't get the lead runner. But she got the out.
Newland is 0 for 2. Ball one. These teams will trade locations tomorrow at 2:30. LSU will be at the Ragin' Cajuns. Newland has been good with runners in scoring position this year, batting .455 with runners in scoring position. A little pop-up carries out to the grass on the right side, and Langoliers backs up to grab it. You know, over the last two innings of that, when LSU has managed to get some base runners, Shorman has just kind of accelerated her game a little bit. And she has done a good job of avoiding hot spots.
I think I said it at the beginning. She throws big pitches in tight situations. And she's done that today.
Very well said. Indeed true. LSU is 2 for 7 today with runners in scoring position. There's Bergeron. LSU needs more base runners. We're in the sixth. A home run by Clark to lead it off, and then a base hit by Ruderty. But now there are two outs.
Solo home run, which is kind of the difference in the two home runs.
Bergeron has struck out and reached on a throwing error by the shortstop. The pitch, way wide. Gutierrez is on deck. Shorman to the freshman.
Ooh,
a little bit off the plate outside.
That was close.
Slightly wide by a cigar stub.
One of those little skinny ones.
Mm-hmm. The 2-1 pitch. Swing and a miss.
Big swing by Bergeron.
A pretty good cut of that, but maybe slightly tardy.
I'm going to say Bergeron because I got a text saying that her grandparents say Bergeron.
That ought to be good enough.
Of course, my name is Girouard and I say Girouard.
Both of them are gorgeous names. The 2-2 pitch coming. Big pitch about to be on its way.
Jammed her good there.
Yeah.
Macy had just enough strength to foul that ball off.
That's nice when you can work it in a couple of inches above the hands, isn't it?
Well, she's worked outside and then she's jammed her in. The player's sweating today. It's been nice and warm here for February.
83 degrees at game time. Second consecutive day Baton Rouge has experienced 80 plus.
In February.
Here's the 2-2. Fouled again. That one was also on the inner part of the plate. Not quite as tight as the first one. LSU has not scored since the first inning. 62% is the humidity right now, a bit. The azaleas are in bloom around town. Not maybe at full bore yet, but
close.
But getting there.
Ooh, that's a tough one to look at.
That was an off-speed pitch, and she recognized it. 3-2. LSU's dugout is going through all kind of gyrations down there, trying to encourage Bergeron. Here's the pitch from Shoreman. That might have been ball four, but it was in on the hands.
That ball's just running in on her.
It is. That was 66 miles an hour. That's a tough pitch to handle coming in on the hands.
Self-defense. Orchestrated cheer. And you got the guys in the dugout doing it.
The full count pitch. Upstairs, and that's a really good at bat by a rookie.
Absolutely.
You know, and I've said this before, sometimes you're walked, and then there are other times when you earn a walk.
And she
earned that one.
You're right about that, Lynn. She swung at some pitches that were borderline. She felt like she had to swing, fouled them off.
So now the tying run is at first base. The go-ahead run is at the plate. Gutierrez has walked and been hit by a pitch. Steve, right. No home runs for Gutierrez. She is not known as a home run threat. She can drive a ball into the gap. Top of the order is on deck. Can Gutierrez extend the inning? That's wide. One ball, one strike. Oh, a little drama here in the sixth. This is what we come to the park for.
120 pitches. Shoreman's laboring a little bit, but once again has made those big pitches in tight situations.
She really has. And she has 25 pitches this inning. Make it 26 now. She had more than 30 in the first inning. In between, though, she was really economical.
Well, she took control of the game, no
mm-hmm.
question.
Mm-hmm.
And then her defense really helped her out with that highlight reel catch in center field. Once again, this is a big out here.
A little bit elevated, and it's 3-1. And you can see Shoreman, who is very deliberately questioning that call by the umpire.
And look at her. As I said, she's laboring.
The face is flushed as she tries to work out of a hot spot here. Three balls and a strike. Gutierrez can afford to be selective on this pitch. Swinging, wrapping it up the middle. The runner rounds third. There will be no throw from center field. Gutierrez drives in a run, and the Tigers are within one.
Been a nail biter the whole time. That's a big 3-1 swing by Gutierrez. And Walker, she didn't do a do or die. She didn't come get it to try and make that great play at the plate. It's almost like she was conceding. She couldn't throw her out.
So Raylene Gutierrez has been on board three times. She delivers a two-out RBI single to tighten this game to one. The Cajuns still lead it 5-4. And we'll have an offensive conference. We'll have a defensive conference. We may have a call to the bullpen here.
I think we will.
The wheels are turning everywhere.
It's been a great ball game so far.
There is bullpen activity for the Cajuns. And we will have a pitching change. This game is tighter than the top string on a Texas fiddle. We'll be right back. 5-4. The Raging Cajuns lead it.
New pitcher for the Cajuns, now in circle number 20.
As we work in the bottom of the sixth inning, Chloe Riacetto has come in out of the bullpen to relieve Megan Shoreman. Riacetto is a freshman with no record, a 6.63 ERA. She did work three innings in the first game today, walked a batter, struck out four, did not give up a base hit, and was really good in effect in relief against Texas A&M Corpus Christi.
Going to be a totally different look, obviously. She's a lefty. She's going to throw a drop curve and that backdoor curve. So just trying to keep the Tiger bats off balance here.
So Megan Shoreman is lifted after 5 2/3 innings. And here is Coffey. Stee, right one. Coffey has walked and scored. She has flied to center, and she has fouled out to the left fielder.
There's that drop ball right away.
The 0-1 pitch with the tying run at second base. The go-ahead run at first. That's fouled away, and let's look at Shoreman's work today. She was really good between the second and sixth innings. She gave up two in the first and then was virtually unhittable through the next four at-bats by the Tigers. LSU has been able to punch through with a pair here in the sixth inning. Six hits allowed in 5 2/3, three walks, six strikeouts, four earned runs to this point.
Kind of looking at her elbow, she was pointing to it, but I don't, that's a little backdoor curve there. But totally different look. Shoreman is the hardest thrower on the team, and now you got this funky stuff coming out.
Riacetto looking into her dugout. Chloe spins the ball in her hand. Here it comes. Swing and a miss.
On a
Coffey chased one that was well outside the strike zone, but it looked good when it left the hands of Chloe Riacetto. Georgia Clark got the inning started with her fourth home run of the year and her second in as many days. That helped the Tigers get a little bit closer. We move on, a one-run lead for the Cajuns. Each team has six hits. The Raging Cajuns lead by one. We play in the top of the seventh. Louisiana is trying to snap a five-game crossover tournament losing streak to the LSU Tigers. These clubs will get together tomorrow in Lafayette. And that'll be a 2:30 Central time start. That game will be available on ESPN Plus. Cecilia Vasquez is the opening hitter. 0-4-1 today. She popped up to the first baseman and then she was pinch hit for in her second, what would have been her second at bat. Sydney Berzon has been pitching since the third inning. Pleasance is waiting on it. Makes the strong throw and a good stretch by Gutierrez. And Vasquez is out by a half step.
And she can wait on it because she's got that big, strong arm.
One gone in the top of the seventh. Looking ahead to the bottom of the inning, it'll be Briggs, Pleasance, and Clark due up for LSU. Right now, though, Berzon's job is to keep her team down by only one.
She's thrown well after she came in relief. She was a little shaky there.
Sophie Piskos is at the plate right now. She is pinch hitting for Falterman, who had walked and scored and grounded out.
And it's rare that Piskos is not starting in the lineup. I think you can say that she's the heart and soul of this Cajuns team. She's very active when she's a catcher.
From Paris, Tennessee. Berzon overthrows that one. One ball, one strike, one out. One run game in the seventh. The outfield is deep and straight away. We have seen a dandy here. No chance for Pleasance to make that play on the backhand side. And that'll be an infield hit off the glove of Pleasance. That ball was chopped. It was kind of an awkward hop. She had to go a long way and reach across on the backhanded side. And just not able to do it. That's a base hit 100% of the time.
Good job by Piskus coming off the bench and getting a base hit. Not always that easy.
So Falterman will come back in the game on the re-entry rule, and she'll be the runner at first base. Here's Davis. 1-for-3 at the top of the order, and she certainly made her mark defensively in the third inning. And I say this with no hyperbole, it was the best catch I have ever seen.
I think so, too. I would agree with you.
We just showed you a picture of the mark on the wall that she left after the crown of her head just would have driven a spike into the left center field wall. Just an unbelievable catch. Truly unbelievable. Out on a very close play.
And that ball had some funky spin.
It did. It had English on it and French and Italian too.
Are they going to appeal this call?
They are.
The green flag under review.
Well, he's got two. He hadn't used any. Am I correct there? Is this his first appeal? Let's see what we got here. Can't tell from that angle if she has the ball.
Out. Remember, no such thing as tie goes to the runner. Boy, that's really, 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 really close. When you were playing,
who came up with that tie goes to the runner?
You know, I don't know.
I
was going to ask you when you were playing as a kid. Was it tie goes to the runner? Tie goes to the runner.
Probably said as coach.
I don't know that there's enough to overturn it. It is very, very tight.
Out.
So they do uphold the original call.
It was close.
Now batting third baseman number 3, Maddie Hayden.
Here's Maddie Hayden. She's 0 for 3. 0 for 2 against Berzon. She was the first batter that Berzon faced in the second inning, or rather the third inning, and she went down on strikes.
Not
she
very
also
often.
Bounced out to third last time.
It's not very often you say that stat with Maddie Hayden.
Yeah, you're right. Hitting 333 this year with runners in scoring position, and she's got a teammate at second base right now. I bet you well know the importance of the runner at second base for the Cajuns. Really for both sides. If it's a one-run ball game, anything can happen.
If it's two, it's a little deflating when they go in that dugout.
5-4 Cajuns on the strength of a two-run uprising in the second and three more in the third. Berzon stares in disbelief. She didn't get the right hand elevated.
She's three balls kind of laughing about it. Fans are on blue. Go figure.
Now, first base is open, but you've got Stormy Kotzelnik on deck. A four-pitch pass.
Jerry Glasgow talks about Kotzelnik, elite talent, no limit to how good she can be.
Well, she's grounded out twice and homered. A two-run home run in the third inning.
And I keep saying, you know, it's a two-run shot. LSU's was a single shot. And the big error, I think, is the difference in the game. And, of course, the catch in center field, blah, blah, blah.
You mentioned Kotzelnik's high ceiling. She's hitting 444 with runners in scoring position.
Dangerous hitter for the Tigers.
And let's see if this carries out to Newland. It does. Newland squeezes it for the third out. LSU is down to its last three outs. We go to the bottom of the seventh, and the Raging Cajuns have a 5-4 lead. So you've always wondered what the gloaming is. You're looking at it right now. We are in the gloaming here in Baton Rouge. And a one-run ball game. The Raging Cajuns came from two off the pace in the second inning and scored twice and then got three more in the third. They yielded two in the sixth. And we play here in the bottom of the seventh inning. LSU, undefeated on the year, trails by one. It's Sierra Briggs, Taylor Pleasance, and Georgia Clark against the relief pitcher, Chloe Riacetto. Ball one to Briggs. Riacetto came on and got Danica Coffey in relief in the sixth inning with two aboard. So Megan Shorman working 5 2/3, and now Chloe Riacetto.
The teeth of the Tiger lineup.
That's line foul. Missed an extra base hit by a couple of strides. Briggs has more hits than any other Tiger. Pleasance has more RBIs than anybody in the country. And then you've got Clark, who has homered and singled in this game and driven in two. That's what faces Riacetto. Here we go. Beautifully done by Hayden. She jumped on that like a rat on a Cheeto. Maddie Hayden, with no room for hesitation.
Played the entire year last year in the outfield and just made a tremendous play there from third. Cuts this ball off. It's not even close.
And not often do you get Briggs by a step and a half.
Not even close.
Well, here's Pleasance now. Every batter in the seventh represents the tying run. Ball one.
You see that big sweeping curveball going to the outside corner.
LSU is, and LSU has not seen many left-handed pitchers this year. Nobody does, really. Pleasance takes ball two. Georgia Clark is on deck. One out, a one-run game, bottom of the seventh. LSU 13-0 on the year. But it is in jeopardy. Ball three. Pleasance has had a few at-bats against left-handers this year. She's 1-for-4. She's hitting .436.
And nobody has hit the ball better in the Tiger lineup than the person on deck.
Pleasance .436 against right-handers. The pitch. Off
same
the mark,
spot.
A four-pitch pass.
Every curveball was almost in the same spot.
Well, this crowd is going to come to full throat.
Of a pinch runner for Pleasance. No need to leave the bunny rabbits on the in the dugout. Bunny rabbits aren't bunny slow.
That's Townsend.
Jack rabbits.
Townsend is going to run. Clark has had four at-bats against left-handed pitching this year. And she's got two hits.
Just love these edge of the seat ball games.
That is a great description. So apt. Winning run at the plate. Veteran Georgia Clark with the pipe in her hand. Steve Reich on the outside edge.
And you tell her, you know, you got to make sure she just threw four straight balls. Might have been an automatic take.
One ball, one strike. Mackenzie Ruderdy is on deck. She is a left-handed hitter. One out, one on, one-run game. Raging Cajuns. Trying to do to LSU what no team has done yet, and that is get a victory.
My gosh, the outfielders for the Cajuns are on top of the wall.
Yeah, they are scratching their backs on the wall in the outfield.
Especially Falterman in left field.
She can go no farther. Davis is near the warning track in center field. And the right fielder is near the warning track as well. Yvette, I'm a little surprised they're that deep because anything hit over their head is a home run.
Exactly.
And you got a runner at first base, so if you can cut one off in the gap, perhaps you can hold that runner to third. To me, this is a little bit of an overthink. Two on Clark. This is why we come to the ballpark. The make it happen pitch in flight.
Got jammed.
Ground ball, left side, bobble, scoop, out at second base. Vasquez was able to make the recovery in time.
She was so excited to get that ground ball because she might have had an opportunity for a double play and it kind of ate her up, but she did get the lead out.
A 6-4 put out. This ball had a little spin to it right there, and as she tried to reach into her glove make the throw, she got it over to second base just in time, and we'll have a pinch runner for Clark, Michaela Walker.
Walker now running for the
Tigers. So Walker will use first base as the starting block, and Ruderdy is the scheduled hitter.
That was a great pitch. Jammed her on the inside, didn't let her get extended.
Well, now they're going to review the play at second base, and I'm pretty sure that this is going to be upheld in a hurry.
Yeah, might as well use them, but I'm pretty 90% positive that she's out. Out.
That might have been the shortest appeal we've had.
Well, we'd hope so.
9.2 seconds.
Game of inches. Not sure who Kilponen is calling right now. She's actually got her jersey on backwards. Talk about superstitions. Somebody has their glasses upside
down. I like
it,
don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Rudity with two outs. Ball one. The Cajuns are one out away from beating LSU, the first defeat of the season for the Tigers. Rudity swings through a pitch. She struck out in the first. She struck out in the fourth, and she dropped a base hit behind the shortstop in her last at bat. Petty is on deck, two gone, one on, one run game. That's tight and high.
What a totally different look, though, she is.
Mm-hmm.
Good reliever out of the bullpen.
Riosetto to the plate. Steve, right.
That drop curve inside.
And a good one.
Backdoor curve. Or...
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. A one-run game. A runner at first base. Rudity, 2-for-5 against left-handed pitchers this year. Can she extend the game? No, she cannot. The Raging Cajuns get the win as they come from behind with two in the second and three in the third. And for the first time this season, LSU is on the losing side of the final score. What a ball game.
Cajuns had played some tight ball games last week and came away the losers a bunch of times, but they never gave up, and they didn't today. The Tigers jumped on them, but there was no quit in the Cajuns.
Well, the Raging Cajuns get the job done, 5-4 the final. And we will have another game with the Texas A&M Corpus Christi Islanders taking on the LSU Tigers in about 30 minutes or so. But this one is done. The Raging Cajuns are winners. That wraps it up for the moment. Don't forget, we've got more softball coming a little bit later on the SEC ESPN Network. For Yvette Girard, I'm Lynn Rollins. Again, the final score, Raging Cajuns 5, Tigers 4. That's all for now from the ballpark.